followed? Do we have any equipment considerations or pre-planning aspects that need to be addressed for future events? All these things are taken into consideration when we evaluate our officer-involved shootings. So what I would like to do, I'm going to start with 3006 Mason, and then I will go into Menalusa and Newport, the one occurred last night. On 3006 Mason Street, the officers received a 911 call of an adult male shooting a gun. The officers arrived and encountered the male inside an SUV. He was in the driver's seat. An officer announced that he could see a gun in Mr. Jeremiah Wilson's hand. The officers took up a position to cover. Officer Lombardo was closest to the driver's side and initiated verbal commands and de-escalation statements to try to get him to put the gun down. Behind Officer Lombardo, more to the rear of the SUV, was Officer Justin Georges. Officer Lombardo has been on the job for 1.5 years, and Officer Georges is a 14-year veteran. He was positioned behind cover behind the vehicle. Both officers were behind cover. We could clearly hear body-worn camera audio. The video was partially obscured due to the officers being behind cover. The officers were fearful of him going mobile or getting out of the car, as he was armed with a gun and in a very agitated state of mind. They spoke with him, mainly Officer Lombardo, for 6 minutes as Mr. Wilson displayed a very agitated state. At one point, at 3:11 hours, he stated, "Shoot me," with an explicative, "I'm going to shoot you." Witness officers and Officer Lombardo said he made a movement with the gun towards him. Officer Lombardo described him actually making eye contact at that point in time and moving the weapon towards Officer Lombardo. And that's when Officer Lombardo and Officer Georges fired their service weapons, striking Mr. Wilson, who died from his injuries. On the floorboard of the SUV was a 9mm Ruger. No round was in the chamber and no rounds were in the magazine. The officers did find two 9mm shell casings in the street area. Witnesses said he was shooting off the gun that prompted the 911 call. I've analyzed everything we have so far on this particular matter, and the officers' actions were in accordance to our policy. In addition, this particular incident had elements of the phenomenon of suicide by cop. I'm going to move into the Menalusa officer-involved shooting now, and at the end, I'll take some of your questions. Menalusa Boulevard and Newport Avenue. This was a pre-planned annual neighborhood event. It's a Halloween event that takes place every year. Several officers were assigned. They were in police uniform with marked police cruisers. They were working on a grant. They interface with the public. It's a good community policing event where we get an opportunity to interact during Halloween with the kids. But also, anytime law enforcement officers are there, they're there to protect the public. This event was barricaded off with large construction barricades to prevent vehicular traffic from coming down up and down Menalusa Boulevard. Hundreds were in attendance, to include strollers and very small children who struggled to walk in their first Halloween costumes. Officer Bryson Blanford, a 4-year veteran of the Omaha Police Department, had his cruiser parked on the median and was handing out candy to the kids from the trunk of that cruiser. He was talking to them when he heard a broadcast by another officer come out that a vehicle had just entered the barricaded area. And you could see the officers on body-worn camera start to look for that vehicle. Some of the officers go one direction. Officer Blanchford sees the vehicle come in his direction, and he swims through the kids and puts himself in front of this moving vehicle, which is perforating the crowd. Some of the crowd is barely getting out of the way at that point. He stands in front of the vehicle. He announces 5 times for the driver to stop. The driver does not, and he fires his service weapon 7 times, striking the driver, who is identified as Mr. Dontavius Levering, 32 years old. He was struck 3 times, once in the jaw and once in each shoulder. The vehicle comes to a rest, and Levering is taken out of the vehicle and first aid is administered. He is currently in stable condition right now. It is our job as police officers to put ourselves into harm's way to protect the public. Officer Blanchford did exactly that, and it is not hard to imagine his actions saved lives. This was a crowded street, barricaded off, small children unable to move quickly without adult assistance was the backdrop that Officer Blanchford left. That's what he left behind when he stood in front of that vehicle. His intention was to protect the public from that vehicle, and he performed in an admirable state. My evaluation so far of this incident is ongoing, as we haven't completed the investigation totally. We haven't had the opportunity to actually talk to the officer involved yet, but from everything I've seen from the body-worn camera footage, this was in accordance to policy, and if that changes, I'll certainly update the public on that. The incident at 3006 Mason will go in front of a grand jury. On the Minnelusa incident, the matter will be presented to the county attorney, who will make a charging decision. Myself and Captain Christensen are available for your questions at this time.
You just said 32. Our release says 31. Can you confirm age?
So the date of birth was, I believe, February of 1991. So whose math is right there?
Chief, you mentioned that in the Mason case, the motive might have been suicide by cop.
Yes.
Any idea what the motive might have been for the situation in Minnelusa? Is that any indication of any sort of terrorist or political reason for doing this? Or
right. So the question was, what is the potential motivation for Minnelusa, as I gave the motivation of suicide by cop on the first incident? Tom, it's really hard to tell at this point. We don't really see any terrorist ties. I can't say that the motorist was trying to run people down. It did appear that he was under the influence of something from the body-worn camera, but we don't have toxicology reports back. The information to that officer at the time, it was dark, the vehicle had no lights off, entered into a barricaded area, very crowded area with the crowd reacting to the car. It was a danger. The officer stepped in the car's way in order to stop that particular threat. The motive behind that right now is unknown, but we can rule out the terrorist aspect of it. And it does not appear that he was attempting to mow down as a mass casualty incident, because there was an opportunity to do that. People were diving out of the way and they were getting out of the way, but it didn't look like they were being targeted. He was at an area where definitely a vehicle is going to be a major problem.
Have you had a chance to speak with the Minnelusa suspect at all now that he's in stable condition?
We have not.
Do we know if that man lived in the neighborhood? We have been talking to some neighbors who said that possibly he was helping kids either pass out candy or decorate cookies, something like that, before this happened. Any idea?
Well, so that'd be the first we heard of that. And we don't know if he lives in the area or not. It's still part of our investigation. Obviously, we'll backtrack who he is, every aspect of where he lives. What's his history? What's his propensity for things? We'll get into all that. It's just we haven't, due to his injuries at this point, and we are less than 24 hours away. But we just felt it was important because we are now on the heels of two officer-involved instances, one occurring on Halloween night with small children involved. We wanted to get out in front of the cameras to let your stations know so you can relay to the public what we have.
What does it mean to you to see the officer from last night? I mean, you kind of touched on it a minute ago, but be willing to put himself in that danger and protect everybody that was around him.
Yeah, you know, we've had three officer-involved shootings this year. In each one, you have to ask yourself, you have to extrapolate at times, what would have happened if law enforcement wouldn't have been there? What would have happened if law enforcement didn't take the action that they did? And on the three that we've had, I'm proud of the response. On the Minnelusa incident, that officer essentially swam through kids to get in front of that car. We don't necessarily train to stand in front of a car. That can be a dangerous situation. On this occasion, that officer felt he needed to try to prevent that car from barreling into a crowd. And realize that officer just left kids, some of them, and you know the image when I said they struggled to even walk in their costumes. And he knew that was in his background. and he took very heroic action because of that.
How are the officers doing? I imagine firing shots like this would be rather traumatic. How are they doing?
Tom, I'm going to check on that. I always make a rule that I don't talk to them while the investigation is ongoing. When the investigation concludes, that's when I'll place a call to them and see how they're doing with their own state of mind. Because physically, we know they're fine. But how is their own state of mind after that? I haven't had a chance to do that yet by design.
I'm sure your team has mapped out every bullet that came out of your officer's gun last night. Do you know if all of them went into the car? There are lots of rumors that some may have hit homes, some may have, but no one was hit. But do you know that all of them went into that car?
I know that it sure appeared that at least six did, maybe all of them, and it's possible that a round went through and through the car. Okay, so our rounds will go through a car door. Okay, and two of the rounds occurred on the side.
But you're not aware, no one has reached out to you to say, my house was hit by gunfire?
Not that I have heard. And remember, we're less than 24 hours into this. It's a dynamic, it's a fluid situation.
The neighborhood talked about wanting to make sure the event is still safe in the future. Is that something you work with that neighborhood association on, or how's that work?
So we'll do some pre-planning on this. Every incident we go through here and incidences we see across the country, we try to learn from those. It's not new to have a car go barreling through a crowded street. A lot of times that can take on various different motives. Either way, it's a very dangerous situation. So you have to ask yourself, how will we barricade these events off in the future to make them safer? We did use large street construction barriers here that were clearly visible to all cars. It's going to be hard to have concrete barriers. It's going to be hard to utilize barriers that completely prevent physical access into every event. But as the events get larger, as the events we occur annually, we definitely will take a look at how we can pre-plan this. If it can be done better, we're going to do that. That's kind of the final stage of this. Right now we're in the investigative stage determining if the legality threshold was met, our policies and procedures were met, then we'll get into training, we'll get into equipment, and then we'll get into pre-planning. All those layers will be touched on with each one of these instances.
What does administrative leave detail? I mean, what are these officers doing now? How long will it take for the grand jury? What happens between now and then?
So they're placed on administrative leave until I can determine through the internal affairs process if I deem this to be a situation in which they're ready to come back to work. While they're on administrative leave, that's a status in which they are accessible to us. And that's why one of the reasons they're placed on administrative leave. If we have follow-up interviews, follow-up questions, anything of that nature, they are at our disposal. Once we determine that policy and legality-wise, they're ready to come back to work, we do make sure that they go see a psychologist to make sure they're mentally prepared to come back to work at that point in time. Once those hurdles are crossed and jumped over, that's when the officers will return to work. And so they're, at this point in time, we have three officers on administrative leave, and be the three officers that fire their firearms, two in one incident, and then the one from last night. Okay, I want to thank the media for coming here on short notice. I want to thank our community for assisting us with the Halloween event. I want to thank the community for their support of the law enforcement officers and the aftermath of these events. I think our community understands that law enforcement officers oftentimes have to be placed in dangerous situations and unenviable situations, but they do it to try to protect the public. And I hope that everyone sees that this occurred on these occasions. And so I just leave everybody with that. Please have a good evening.
Thank you.